I once read it to you. It's in Ezekiel chapter 3. It says, if you warn the wicked and he repented, he will be saved and you saved your soul, yourself. If he did not repent, he will pay for his crimes and you saved your soul. If you didn't warn him, you are guilty for his crimes. Guilty. Someone asked me this week from England, where is the source for it? I'm having an argument with my friends. They don't believe that you're guilty for other people's crimes. So I said, I can give you 300 sources from the top of my head. But let me give you one. Moshe hit the rock. Hashem told him, speak to the rock. All the lefty liberals, Datan and Aviram and all the other wicked people, they were making fun. One or two drops came out. Then Moshe hit the rock second time. Rivers of water came out. River was enough for the whole nation. Millions gonna drink now. They were silent, all the clown. All the wicked clown finally closed their dirty mouth. But Moshe and his brother Aaron, that minute, Hashem signed that they will not enter the Holy Land. That was the dream of their life. That was the purpose of their life. That's what they gave every minute of their life for that mission, for that target. That was their target, to hit the Holy Land. After they babysit the people and all the pests, and all the nudniks out there, who constantly give them hard time, they tolerated that for one purpose, that they should enter the land of God, as it's promised in the Torah. And both of them did not enter Israel, such a horrible punishment. Moshe, for eating the rock instead of speaking to the rock. That was it. It's written, Mei Meriva, for that I'm not letting you go into Israel. It's a clear verse in the Torah. The question is why Aaron didn't go in. Aaron was a big tzaddik. He was loved by everyone. When he passed, the entire nation cried for him. Everyone. For 30 days. There was not one person that was happy that Aaron passed. When Moshe passed, some people were very upset. Some people were happy. Why? Oh, Baruch Hashem, we got rid of this dictator who tells us what to do. He already executed Mechalel Shabbat. You know how people are. The wicked people, they always look at the leader or the rabbi as a source to the problem. They're not going to blame themselves. Like King Solomon already said. King Solomon wrote, Ivelet Adam tesalef darko, ve'al Hashem is af libo. Stupidity of a person will turn him away from the right path to Hashem. And he is going to blame Hashem. Or he's representatives, such as the rabbi, or Moshe Rabbeinu, or the Kohen. So the question is why Aaron had to get such a punishment. He was not holding the stick. The answer is, because in the first time when Moshe hit the rock, Aaron could not see it coming. Right? Moshe already did it. He couldn't stop it. But when he raised his hand for the second time to give another shot, Aaron should have held his head. He should have not letting him do it. Because he knew that Hashem told him, speak to the rock and don't eat the rock. He didn't tell him to eat the rock. So on the first time, Aaron was not guilty. Because he didn't see that Moshe is about to eat the rock. How is he supposed to know? But when Moshe lifted his hand to eat the rock for the second time, Aaron was standing there and he didn't rebuke him. He got the same exact punishment like Moshe. Same exact punishment. You see your cousin Mechalel Shabbat and you say nothing to him, it counts like you are Mechalel Shabbat. It's a clear verse in the Torah. Clear verse in the Torah. Hocheach, tochiach et amitecha, ולא תישא עליו חטא. Rebuke your brother, the member of your nation, someone who follow Torah, believes in Hashem, that you should not be held guilty for his crimes, for his sins. One comment that some people are not aware of, this obligation to rebuke Jews does not apply to every Jew. Some Jews are not considered Jews, even though their biological mother is Jewish. In Shamayim, Hashem is looking at them as 100% non-Jews. Chalel Shabbat, areu kegoy lechol davar. Someone who's an idol worshiper is like a goy. Mechalel Shabbat is like a goy. So who do we have an obligation to rebuke? Someone that believes in God, believes that there is such a thing, Torah. We're not talking about a religious person. Just a believer. He believes there is a God. He believes there is a Torah. I mean, when Chiloni, when he sees the Torah, he runs to kiss. Or if he sees someone walks in into the place where the Torah is going to stand up. Or if he walks into a synagogue, to a bar mitzvah, or to a funeral, he's going to put a yarmulke on. Meaning he has some connection to tradition. Someone like that, it's mitzvah to try to save him. Some lefty liberal like Bernie Sanders or Chuck Schumer and the rest of these wicked people, there's no obligation to rebuke them. You let them stay wicked until they die and pay for all the crimes. You leave them like that. You don't have an obligation to run and beg them to become righteous. A lot of people don't know it. They don't know it. If you will do it, and you get one of these wicked people to repent, that's a huge achievement. That's unbelievable. But if you didn't run after them to rebuke them and to make them religious, you will not be held responsible for their crimes. So you have to know. In Israel, unfortunately, half of the people are in this category. Here in America, there's a lot of wicked people, but a lot of them have no idea what does it mean to be wicked. You have Jews in America here that grew up 100% like goyim. Some of them were even sent to Christian schools, private schools that are following Christianity. Some Jews. I even met one time a Jew that his name was Chris Cohen. Chris Cohen. Just to show you how dumb his parents were. That they called him in such a name. It's like calling someone Muhammad Levy. You don't know if to laugh or to cry. So, for that, by the way, you should know, if the obligation to rebuke was to every Jew, include the most wicked ones, include people like Bernie Sanders, or Bennett, or Ehud Barak, or Aaron Barak, and Lieberman, and the rest of the Reshaim Afar Lepiem, then we would not have a life. We would have to stand in the streets of Tel Aviv all day and scream, Shabbat, Shabbat, how can you drive on Shabbat? And obviously they will make fun at us all day. Take pictures of us, laugh at us, throw things at our head, throw eggs at us. We would have no life. Hashem, Baruch Hashem, is reasonable. He didn't ask us or command us to rebuke such field. Leave them alone. Al itenu larasha ve'yamot. He will have a problem with me when the time comes. Otherwise, we have no life. We couldn't live, couldn't have a family life, couldn't raise your children. You would have to be standing on the street. Everywhere you go, excuse me, why you walk without a yarmulke? Excuse me, why you don't have tzitzit? Excuse me, why you walk not modest? That's all you have to do. There's no such obligation. Your obligation is to speak to someone that you know there is a chance that he would listen to you. If there is no such chance that you know that he's going to get angry, some lefty liberal, hater of God, haters of religion, or some gay, as soon as you talk to him about religion, he want to kill you because it jeopardizes his desires. People like that, you don't have to risk yourself. People that have respect to the religion, meaning if they see Rabbi on Shabbat, they wouldn't light a cigarette in his face. People like that, you have to do everything you can to save them. Why? They have good background. How long, how many times you have to rebuke a person? How many times? The answer, up to 100 times. Or, if he yell at you with anger or beat you up, or threaten to beat you up, then you don't have to. said to him, if you talk to me about Shabbat one more time, I'll break your head. Okay. You don't want me to talk to you? I don't want to talk to you. No problem.